by.
Morning and welcome to a very chilly Juma private game reserve. You have the Killer Bees, Brent, that's me, and Brian with the thumb behind the camera. Now we've come up to the northern boundary. What's that in the road? I think it's a stick. I got very excited there. So we've come up to the northern boundary. I'm looking for those Inkahuma girls that we saw at the end of the safari last night. And I just heard they went further east. So hopefully they've stayed on Juma. Now, of course, on the other vehicle, making his first vehicular appearance in quite some time, we have the winter farmer, Stefan Winterboer, and who's on camera with him? Dave, this morning. And then in the final control, we have Kirsten, and who else is there today? Oh, Chelsea Button's there today. And remember, we're on a live African safari, and hoping to find some big cats, but also whatever else might be out here. And you can ask us questions by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can pop us an email, questions@wildearth.tv. Okay, so we're going to check very carefully around here. The light is not great, as you can see, and makes looking for tracks a little bit difficult, but we will give it our best go. Now the last position of those lionesses, we're heading east from Gari Cutline, so towards Buffalo's Hook Dam. Only two of them, one lioness, seem to have been left behind in the river system below the Vuyatela dam wall. Now, I'm not sure if everyone knows what happened last night after the end of a drive. The lions tried to catch a buffalo right in front of the Juma dam camp. Now, I thought they were going to go pop down for a drink. I spoke to final control. They said there was nothing at the Vuyatela pan, so we ended drive, and Chelsea Bunn had never seen a lion before, so I went and picked up Connor, Kirsten and Chelsea, and we went and followed them for a little bit and got to see them chase a buffalo literally feet from the car. Now, well, actually let me rephrase, we got to listen to them chase a buffalo because we're sitting in the dark, and just that pounding was quite impressive. They were unsuccessful, but they were hungry, so I'm pretty sure they would have carried on hunting. So while we continue to search for the Inkahuma ladies, let's go see what the winter farmer is up to. Good morning, good morning, and what a wonderful, rare and special treat it is to have me driving in one of these cars. I must be honest, even at the snail's pace that I'm driving at the moment, things are still happening much faster than they happen on the bushwalk. I'm missing tracks, I'm missing things, it feels like I need to slow down even more than I am. But nevertheless, I'm going to give it a bash, and we'll see whether or not I'm able to fit right into vehicle safaris again after a long absence in the driving chair. All those of you who are joining us for the first time, welcome. And today I'm probably on a mission to aid Brent as much as what that goes against my very nature. And what happened to these Inkahuma ladies? It's not. Inkahumas are inhabiting home, their territory. Of our train. I want to put that down a little bit. I have yet to master the skill of having three different voices in my ear. For the tend to move lioness that are relatively fast. They run until they run out of when they're hunting. It's easiest. We found that lions are predominantly nocturnal hunters. Which is 3 miles or so. That food. You can do about 3 weeks without really needing a meal. Longer than at about two weeks are starting to look ragged, and at a month without food can't even stand anymore. Now I have seen lions that are on the verge of starvation. Not that these lions are anywhere close to starvation. In actual fact, far from it. I think that it's going to become much easier for these lions to hunt as the drought progresses. The reason for that is animals have to drink. Animals have to drink, and they have to go to the watering holes to drink, and lions are perfect opportunists when it comes to that. Quite often not moving more than a mile or so away from water points. I remember quite fondly a dry season in 2009, I think, where a pride of lions basically put up shop, for lack of a better word, right at a watering point, a seep, a natural seep that came out from underground. And animals would walk right past them, feeding on one of their comrades, and drink and come back again, knowing full well there was no other choice for them to do anything but that. Been quite rude of me this morning. I haven't actually introduced David. He's on camera with me this morning. There you go.
Thanks,
sir. All right, now here's a good place to start looking. A good place to look for tracks is on these sandy corners as you wind your way through the bush. And a few of you are asking, what's happened to James? Absolutely nothing has happened to James. He's having a snooze. I think the tent took it out of him over the course of this last week and the weekend. And we are gifting him the gift of a late morning snooze. Not that he took it to heart. He was up before all of us, as usual, him and Kirsty. So nothing really wrong with him. He's all fine and well, and will be even better once he's had a little bit of sleep and rest. All right, now these are these exposed plains, which are really good for lion. They're good for lion, not because lion like to lie in these exposed plains, but they are very, very good for herbivores. Lots of herbivores in the area enjoy sleeping on open areas and will go towards open areas at nighttime. And for the simple fact is that the short grass and the open bush affords them the ability to see deeper into the bush and therefore give them a little bit of a larger pre-warning zone before predators run in there. Nothing here today. Let's have a look at what's happening here on this corner. And if nothing's happening on this corner, we will send you across to Brent for lion tracks, but nothing to write home about. So off you go, we'll see you in a bit.
We're going very slowly at the moment. I just want to make sure that those lionesses haven't disappeared to the north. We're about to pop down towards the Buffalo's Hook waterhole.
And we've got no tracks coming out yet, so far, so good, they're still in Juma. Really hoping with this weather that came in last night that they managed to catch something. Now, hopefully they caught something big. Now, what happened during that buffalo... Oh, my leg's stuck against steering wheel. Oh, there you go. What happened during that buffalo hunt, it wasn't too serious last night because those were old boys, there were three of them, but they were still quite fresh. I think with three lionesses, it might have been a bit of a big call. Not that it's not possible, I've seen it before. But the circumstances sort of have to fall into place for those girls when that happens. Okay, did you come down the firebreak lines? You did not. Now, of course, the lions could have changed their general direction if they bumped into some more buffalo or anything to hunt. Zebra tracks. Now, there's quite a few people out in the world, and I'm sitting on the fence at the moment about La Nina. Brian, what do you think about La Nina? Do you think it's coming?
Maybe.
See, I'm with Brian, and maybe. See, I'm leaning more to no, we will see. So what La Nina is it's the opposite of El Nino. Oh, there's a hippo going out the water. We'll discuss the weather after we've looked at the hippo. Oh, it's a hippo and calf. So a female and a young one. You probably find what's happened is that they might have even been pressured by the lions into the what's left of the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. And the lions might have moved off and they're now going to try and make their way towards a deeper waterhole in the cool of the morning. Nice and overcast. Not looking too bad yet in terms of condition. Now, the biggest danger for hippos at the moment is the fact that they have to walk massive distance between food and water. And this area, that means they can probably do up to 10 kilometers, maybe even as much as 15 kilometers in a night. Now, in other parts of Africa, they've been known to do up to 50 kilometers in a night. Now, we're not going to try to drive any close to them. Female hippo, drought, young with her. Not worth taking chances around there. So good to just listen to the dawn. I'm very happy. It was spitting rain when I woke up this morning, and it's not at the moment. We can hear an Egyptian goose. Okay, still no sign of those lion tracks. So we were talking about El Nino and La Nina. So Brian thinks possibly yes, I still think it's more likely to be no. But if it is a yes, Yuri and Pippa are being very clever by bolstering all the dams, because if it is a yes, we're going to get early rain and we're going to get lots of it. And, well, in Africa, eventually after drought must come flood. So you'll see some large equipment around here.
Now, what is always incredible is this large equipment doesn't barely affects the animals. I've actually seen leopards and lions sleep between building equipment like this while an airstrip was being built. And sort of actually more get curious about the noise and come have a look than run away from it. But it's something they don't have an instinctive response to. But so far, we've got no lion tracks, which is a good sign. It means they are probably still deeper in Juma. We're going to do a big loop up towards the eastern edge of our traverse area and then start heading back west through the center of Juma. Morning, Siberia. Siberia would like to know if I know if one of those Inkahuma lionesses still has a den very close to Juma. Yes, she's moved to a second den. It's actually closer to the Juma boundary now, but still, unfortunately, just to the east of our traverse area. But those cubs are going to be getting big enough to become mobile and start moving towards kills shortly. Morning, YouTube. Yellow-billed hornbills. Not looking overly impressed with the weather. Come on, do your tok-tok. Quite often when you drive next to them, you turn the car on and they start doing their display. Oh, they're going to fly off. Morning, Shamsun. Shamsun's wondering what's more difficult for the animals to deal with, the drought or flood? I would say definitely drought. Flood only affects the river systems and things like that. It gets very waterlogged and certain animals do have a hard time of it. But drought definitely affects a far larger number of species. Now, even when we have a flood, little rivers like the Mwati will only be sort of raging torrents of impassable water for an hour or two before they go back down. And that, even then, they don't flow for very long after that, and it's just a trickle. Might even be looking in the wrong place. We've just got a message in from Aileen. Thank you very much, Aileen. Aileen said there were four lionesses at the Juma Cam at about 11 p.m. our time. And then at about 1 o'clock, it sounded like the distress calls of a buffalo. So, well, that makes things very interesting and might explain why I haven't seen a lion track yet. So I'm gonna keep with my plan. And if nothing, I will head back towards that area. I'm sure Steph will also give us a hand there. Now let's jump across to Steph, who's got one of the smaller antelope species.
There you have a steenbuck, one of the dwarf antelope that we found out here. And this is a young male. You can just see his horns, little pinprick horns, sticking up between his two ears. Now, a really big steenbuck's horns extend past his ears when they are upright like that. So although this is a full-grown male steenbuck, weighing in and around about 2 pounds, sorry, about 10 pounds. Yeah, he runs off. Still got him. That's good work there, Dave.
Thanks, sir.
That's about as big as what they get. I haven't seen really big ones. It's a mixture of genetics and diet that gives Steenbok large horns in this area. But that is about as big as they grow here. And you find them all over the dry places and the semi-arid places in Africa, or in southern Africa at least anyway, all the way to the deserts of the Namib, through the Kalahari, and down into the Kruger National Park here. They do really, really well. Live in what we call a monogamous pair, which means that it's not a male, like an impala, for instance. It has a male and a harem of females, or a zebra stallion, which has a similar thing, or wildebeest. They pair up, and they will stay together. A lot of people have a misconception that when it says for life, that when one of the pair dies, that they will stay single. That doesn't work out, yeah? So if one of them should get eaten, and they are high up on the menu of a lot of the predator species out here, the very next season, that single animal will look for another partner. In terms of males that are already dominant in an area, it'll be young females that are wandering around finding males. In terms of females who don't have areas, they will start to wander around looking for males that have lost their mates. And they will pair up again, but definitely not more than one or two. And although the pairs look like they hold a territory together, I have read some recent reports that say that the two are only really together when it's time to mate. For the rest of the time, they feed and actively forage around one another in their tiny little territories. Sort of a loose association. And in the deserts, there's a very ancient tribe of people called the Bushmen. And they've been pushed through effectively colonization of Africa by both African and white settlers up into the drier, arid areas of the country. And they make their little rucksacks, their satchels that they carry on the back ends of their backs, that hold their quivers, of their arrows, that hold their fire-making kits and some flint tools and spare arrowheads and such. They make them out of the skins of the Steenbok. Essentially tying the left front leg to the left back leg and vice versa with the other side, and then slinging it over their shoulder upside down. An interesting way of making a backpack, I must be honest. Alright, now I can report that from the looks of things, the lioness did not cross out east across our boundary, and that's quite promising. Brent has done our northern boundary up to Buffelzoek Dam. I've come and done our eastern boundary along Cheetah Cutline, and all the way from way back in the south to where we're coming up to now, which is the corner of our northern and eastern boundaries, I haven't seen any signs of these lioness crossing over into Torchwood, and Brent hasn't found any of them crossing into Buffelzoek, which is good. It means that they may still be on our property. Ah. John has just sent us a picture of one of the Nkuhuma lioness that were drinking at the pan last night. John, I have to say thank you for that. It's always nice for you to share your pictures and comments and questions with us. And for those new to the whole game, you're welcome to send me questions, which I'll try and answer as many of which as I can and are relevant to what we're driving around in. You can do it through two ways. You can email it to questions@wildearth.tv, or you can send it to the Twitter handle #SafariLive, and we will try and screen as much as we can and answer as many questions as we can, as quickly as we can as well. But thanks for that, John. Like I said, it's always nice to share questions and comments like that. Also sometimes helps us find the animals, to be quite honest. All right, let's have a careful look up here at my nemesis. The flies have already started to start bugging me. Have a look down the road there. That is, for me, always quite a nice sight. I love these roads that stretch away into the distance. You can see all the way up there. This is Biffle's Ukatlan and our northernmost boundary through the wilderness. Marianne, good morning to you, or in your particular case, good evening to you, all the way from Arkansas. Marianne, I have happened to find an elephant tusk on a walk before. I found several, in actual fact. Usually where elephant tusks have been broken off during their feeding, you sometimes find them now, especially in the dry season, near hardwood trees. I haven't found much else, to be honest with you. Elephant tusks are fairly resistant to being eroded or weathered away, and so they're quite durable out here. For the rest, we just see a bunch of bones, really, and the discarded remnants of kills. So when you're walking around and you are looking for things out here, you find tusks mainly, and they're very rare to find, actually. I mean, I think I've probably, if I can count, in almost a 2-decade-long run doing these types of things, I found about 4 or 5 elephant tusks on walk and on drive. By far the most common remnants of anything are what's left behind after lions or leopard or cheetah or wild dog have been in the area. I'm just having a look at these junctions. Many of you might already know this, but when we put these roads into this area, they were laid down on existing game paths. When settlers first came in, they would have been mostly on horseback and on foot, and they would have traveled the game paths to and from feeding and water areas, and from one place to another, they would have traveled them in an effort to, firstly, to hunt the animals that were living over here for food, and secondly, to view them much later on when tourism became or came into being. Ecotourism, that is. And they would have laid these game laid the roads down on the game paths that were most prevalent at that particular time. And the animals today still use the roads, still use these old highways, these ancient highways, as roads from one place to another. And it's always a very good thing. You'd notice Brent is a far better tracker than me, spending a lot of his time scanning these roads for tracks and scouring the junctions for signs of passage. For myself, they hold a transient interest, I must be honest with you. I'm more interested in the smaller things out here, the micro world, so to say, beetles and bugs and insects and snakes. Ah, so the jar that has come up into question again. Dee and Marianne have asked me about a jar I found. Now, I did find a jar on walk on Saturday, a pottery jar. It was a handmade traditional pottery jar that had been exposed in a termite mound. And I'm going to go under this tree. It's kind of knocked over the road. And we found it on walk, and we found it on by an aardvark, an ant bear, had dug with his claws into the termite mound. Myself and Jandre had been chased up this termite mound by a particularly determined group of buffalo, and there between my feet I found this jar that was exposed, and I just was lucky enough to share that with some of you. And we washed the side of the jar open with some water, and on it we could see that it was a handmade jar. You could see the rough clay, and you could see the clay fired. Oh, here we have a kudu. Carry on with my story now. Let's have a look at some of these. There's a young male kudu. They have to be one of the most gorgeous looking antelope. There's the female. They're beautiful, soft faces and milky lips. The largest of the spiral horned antelope that we found here, a good 500 pounds worth, not for that female, but that young male that we saw will grow into this mighty being in the next couple of years. Within the next 5 to 6 years or so, he will be a... There's some other kudu and impala on this side. We've driven into the middle of a collection of animals. Not quite the teeming hordes of animals that you see in East Africa in certain places. And that's quite simply because the carrying capacity of the Kruger National Park is lower than that of equatorial Africa, and especially equatorial Africa on the great volcanic plains in Kenya and Tanzania. Here we have about 10 animals. Oh, there we go. Also a young male. You can see that he's in his, going into his third year. Those horns that are still, the tips of his horns that are still pointing away from one another. Here he goes. They're quite often referred to as the ghosts in the bush. Now they're called the ghosts in the bush because you see that they're the same color as the bush in the dry season. And quite often they disappear from view almost instantaneously. Now Aaron has asked me, good morning Aaron. First do greetings this early in the morning. You've asked me what's the largest herd of impala that I've ever seen. Aaron, I'd have to say that it's probably, close on about 50 or 60 animals. I don't think I've seen much bigger than that, thinking about it where I am at the moment. About 50 or 60 animals together, held together by two dominant rams that were just sharing the same block of open area for a night's protection. Now back to our pot. So basically I found this clay pot. It was a traditional clay pot made in the traditional way, baked in a termite mound, and with 4 or 5 lines of pattern scraped into the side. And at the time, and having conferred with Herbert, who is a local Shangaan guy, we deduced that it must have been a treasure pot. What a lot of people do is they used to put their treasures into a pot and bury it in a termite mound, and the activity would cause, the digging activity would cause the termites to then cover up the pot, and only he would know where his treasures are. But after conferring with the landowner here, and also he was very interested in the pot that we found, it could also be a burial pot. Now it doesn't mean that there's a grave there. In actual fact, he was quite certain that it didn't mean that there was a grave there, but it's an offering to the ancestors. Out here amongst the local Shangaan, the worshipping or revering of ancestors is still an honored, it's not quite a religion, but it's basically what they do out here. I don't know how else to articulate that. And they would bury these pots with offerings of beer in termite mounds like this to appease ancestors on the land, that were tied to the land. After speaking with him, he suggested that I go to Juma and find some members of the families, the two families, that live and have lived on Juma for as long as their memories stretch, which in this particular case is probably to around about the 1800s or late 1700s, where these families started moving into this area. And they absolutely said that there's a very good chance. They have no recollection of a grave being there. They have no recollection of a grave offering being there. That it could be either a treasure pot or a grave offering, but from before they can remember. And we've actually got an excursion planned out there for probably this week sometime. That was when the date was set, where we'd take members of this family plus the landowner, and I'd go show them this pot, and then we'd decide amongst one another what the pot is, and whether we should just leave it or whether we should uncover it and bring it into a museum somewhere, our museum or into one of the lodge museums. If it's a burial pot, we're not going to touch that. If it's an appeasement pot to the ancestors, that has to stay in situ. We may not remove it. But if it's a treasure pot, then a discussion will be had around, do you remove it to see what's inside of it? Obviously, I'm wanting it to be a treasure pot. Not that I would have any claim of it. All right. Sabi. Now, I'm sure with the amount of time that you've been with me that Brent is itching to tell you about what he's found. I have no doubt that he's probably circled Juma 500 or 600 times in the time you've been with me. And we're going to send you over to Brent for an update.
I've got some very exciting news. Brian, should I tell them the very exciting news? No, I think we should keep it a secret for a bit longer. So, we have got a report on the radio of something down at Cheetah Plains. Brian, what could be on Cheetah Plains?
A variety of things.
Ah, but what? So, why don't you ponder what's on Cheetah Plains? And I'm going to increase my speed slightly and try get down there. Now, very exciting what is down on Cheetah Plains. Now, normally when I do this, when I'm a long way away, I somehow manage to give it away before we get there. But I managed not to give Mvula away yesterday morning. So, let's see if I can manage not to give what is down on Cheetah Plains. Could it be a cheetah, Brian? It is called the Cheetah Plains, after all. Could be a pangolin. Could be an aardvark. But it is very exciting. And remember, if you've just found us, we are rushing to a surprise sighting live in the African bush. And if you want to know more about the African bush, you're more than welcome to ask Steph or myself, and you can do that by popping us an email and using the email address questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. And or if you want to ask the cameraman a question, you can use the same, and I'm sure they will be happy to answer. Just because we're rushing doesn't mean we mustn't check for tracks. So it is very exciting. We are heading east now on Gowri Main. This is the main access road down towards Cheetah Plains. It's very, very chilly, but we will deal with the cold. Brian and I are both not lovers of the cold weather. Brian, however, has got the largest blanket in the southern hemisphere around him. But the cameramen do have to sit up out in the wind. I've at least got a bit of a dashboard to protect my legs, so we won't make tease him too much about his blankie, because I've also got a blankie. Oh, male lion tracks going down the road. Look a bit old there. So we're about to go down to one of the big dips as we make our way towards Cheetah Plains, and unfortunately sometimes we are live, one must remember, out in the bush, so there are certain dead spots, and there's a very steep little river system up ahead called the Mulwanini, and that often affects our signal. So before we head down into the bottom of the Mulwanini, let us not disturb your viewing pleasure and go across to Steph while we race to Cheetah Plains.
All right, back with us while Brent goes through the signal and troughs that we have. Obviously, the land that we're driving through is a series of in the dips of the deepest ones, our signal can't get to it. There's a signal shadow, for lack of a better word. And as we're driving, we go through them, which causes you to disappear from us, which we'll try and avoid coming to me. We are driving in transects in the line of march from the females from last night. We updated this morning that the last vehicle with them, the lioness that we've been looking for, we're heading in this direction, this way, a mile or so away. And we've now come, we're trying to jump ahead the last tracks. The lioness obviously moved during the night. And what you don't want to do is go and start from old tracks unless you really, really have to. And what you try and do is guess where they're going to be and jump ahead and see if you can pick a lot of intuition. Must be honest with you, Brent is far better at it than I am. I tend to want to go back to the oldest tracks and then follow footstep for footstep like a junior tracker would, rather than thinking in my mind like a lioness and projecting forward where you're most likely to find their tracks. Going there, finding their tracks, and obviously taking it from there. Have a look while we can. It's a rare opportunity to have a go-away bird sitting still against the cloudy sky. We've had a cold front move in late yesterday afternoon and overnight, which has brought with it some cloud. Now, we have a summer and a winter rainfall climate in South Africa. On our west coast, close to Cape Town, we have a Mediterranean climate or winter rainfall. Rain predominantly brought in by cold fronts moving out of Antarctica or off of the Antarctic Sea into and over southern Africa. In this particular area, we're supposed to have a summer rainfall area, and we get our rain generally from tropical air sucked out of the equatorial Africa, or in rare occurrences, our heaviest rain comes in by cyclones off of the Indian Ocean and between the Mozambican Channel. And that's the cloud that you're seeing at the moment. This cloud is just the remnants from a cold front out of Antarctica. Not really what you're watching now. I've said nothing about the grey go-away bird. Excuse me. And that crest that you're having a look at is diagnostic of these particular birds, this family of birds or this group of birds called the turacos. Almost all of them have these crests. I find that the grey lory's crest or the grey go-away bird's crest, the one you're looking at the moment, is probably one of the most fantastic of all their crests, only because they can erect it so straight and upright. Frugivorous birds, and by that I mean they are generally eating fruits and berries and nuts and seeds. They will take insects on occasion, I think. It's actually trying to confirm that at the moment. Let me see. I quite enjoy these birds. They've got a very raucous call that sounds exactly like they're saying go away, which is where they got their name, the grey go away bird, from. Let me see if I can find you a picture of some other turacos. Alright, so food, mostly fruit, but also flowers and buds and insects and nectar. Let me show you how colorful this group of birds are. These are all the turacos. This is the one that we're having a look at right now. And you can see how fantastically colored all of these ones. The one that you're looking at now, this one is also residents in this area. We find a lot of them in the riverine bush. For the rest, we don't find them here at all. The rest are all forest birds, with the grey go-away bird being, and the purple-crested lory being, these two here being the only true bushveld ones. Aren't they fantastic? I would almost argue that the grey go-away bird is the most bizarrely colored of all of them, considering it is completely lacking in color. Very nice. All right. I think we can carry on going. Carry on my endless search for these cats that are seemingly trying to avoid me as best they can for the morning. I've just really been struck for the first time this season at the fact that we've got some autumn colors around us. Now, we don't have a very big autumn, We just sort of got a wet year that goes into a dry portion of the year. But it has struck me that we have many different colored trees around us at the moment. Yellows and reds and oranges. It's just really pretty, to be quite honest. And we've got an elephant just pushed over this tree in our way. Bessie, you've asked me an interesting question. Do we have any plants that are comparable to a North American poison ivy? Yes, we do. It's called a fireweed out here. You don't find it in as abundance, or as you don't find it as abundant as you do your poison ivy. This is literally just a creeper that grows around trees out here, and when you brush against it, burns like you've been burnt by fire. It's really quite disconcerting because it's a pain that grows. It's not a pain that's instantaneously on you. You get hit by one of these plants, and the pain grows and grows and grows to a point, and then gradually subsides away. But yes, we absolutely do. Quite tough to find. Hairy. It's a creeper that's got a lot of hairs on the stem and on the leaves, and you find them growing around the base of trees out here. Right, now we're coming up to a series of drainage lines. Now, what a drainage line is, it's after a seep has wept out its water and there's a bit of runoff happening, water collects in depressions and little gullies and little ravines. We call them drainage lines out here. And we've got a series of drainage lines off to our right-hand side that drain this area of water, drain this crest of water at least anyway, and these lions quite enjoy hunting this area because it has a lot more diverse plant matter. Well, the dendrology here is quite diverse and different as well, and because of that you find a lot of kudu and a lot of buffalo and a lot of giraffe out here, all favorite things for these lioness to hunt. And quite often I've seen these lioness moving through this area. We're just going to keep our ears and eyes open. Here you can see a prime example of the colors that we are talking about here. Are these autumn colors, just before all of these combretums actually lose their leaves, which they'll do in a few short weeks. See the yellows, not as spectacular as you get in other parts of the world, but nevertheless for me quite a striking. Funny, I was asked a question the other day about why we haven't seen that many giraffe lately, and that's actually a very good question. I actually couldn't answer it, to be honest with you. My feeling is that giraffe definitely move in these loose groups together, and you find that the males follow around females and the females walk where they will. Basically, they have a home range. It's not a territory because they don't defend it and they don't mark it out, but they won't walk, for instance, from here to Zimbabwe. They will stay within a certain range. That range is fairly big. And I definitely think that the lack of rain this year has caused these giraffe groups to move around a lot more. And or spread out and become quite dispersed. I think that that's having quite a large effect on us being able to view giraffe. It's not that I haven't seen giraffe. The last giraffe I saw was on Saturday. But before that was probably easily 3 or 4 weeks ago. I don't know when the last time you actually saw giraffe on drive was. I can't remember sitting in final control or hearing on the radio during one of my walks that you were with giraffe. A very good observation that. definitely a distinct lack of life around Juma this morning. Good morning, Justin. You asked me which I prefer, the drives or the walks. I far, far prefer walking, Justin. Not that drives are bad. You get to cover a lot of areas on a drive. You get to see things really close up. You can become part of an elephant herd or become part of a lion pride hunting through the bush. Sit really close to leopard. But walking for me is definitely where it's at. My interests lie in the smaller things. And I find that the micro world out here, spiders and insects and caterpillars and what's going on inside bushes, is far more interesting for me than driving around in the bush. I'm trying to find some tracks of some sleeping lioness, most likely. Not to say that it's not exciting, I'll be honest with you. There's nothing that can top hunting with some lions. Or are we going through some bumps over here? Hunting with some lions or spending time with a leopard as it prowls through the bush has to be one of the most pleasurable times. Alright, now we're going to send you over to Brent, who's just told me that he's got a surprise in store for you. I don't even know what it is.
So what is it? What have I found? What has Andrew and Ephraim found for us on Cheetah Plains? Have you guessed yet? Should we show them now, Brian, or should we?
Let's
show them. There we go. There we go. It is Quarantine. I know he's a firm favorite of a lot of our viewers. Karula's last successful litter produced these two beautiful boys, Quarantine and Kunyuma. Now this is Quarantine. He's looking a little bit miserable this morning with the weather. He's sitting atop a termite mound. He's managed to find himself a nice little nook that's quite protected from the wind. So he's probably 80 meters from the last place we actually saw him here on Cheetah Plains. He's just to the south of Three in a Row Pan. Look at that, isn't that beautiful? He's growing so much. You can start seeing the thickness in the neck now. So I know a lot of you are as excited as I am to catch up with this leopard. When I arrived at Safari Live, he was the leopard we saw the most. Now it's difficult to see how full he is, but I think he's looking a little bit hungry. I hope you guys are getting some fantastic screenshots. Remember to share the screenshots on our Facebook page, Safari Live, or pop them on Twitter with the hashtag Safari Live. I'm going to snap a few pics quickly. Mike in Florida. Mike says he was literally about to tweet that he misses the quarantine male leopard. Well, here we go, Mike. Especially for you on this sunrise safari, we have Quarantine. Is such a beautiful male leopard. He's just over 4 years old now. So another year or two before he's really big enough to start challenging for his own territory.
At the moment, he's what we refer to as a dispersal male leopard. So what that means is he's been pushed out of his natal territory, and he sort of jigs and jags trying to avoid the dominant male leopards in the area. And one of the reasons that they are pushed out of their mother's territory is to stop inbreeding. Although big cats can inbreed for up to 6 generations without any adverse genetic effects, it is an evolutionary development that they are moved away from where their mothers are, and therefore possibly their sisters, because female leopards will sequester a tiny section of their territory to their daughters. Now he's moved probably 10 or 15 kilometers from his natal territory, but in some cases dispersal male leopards have been recorded moving over 400 kilometers from where they were born. Oh, getting comfy. So Dawn's wondering, how does a leopard's fur feel? Is it soft or is it coarse? Well, the belly fur is quite soft. It's not nearly as soft as a domestic cat, for example, but it is less coarse than a lion's. How's that, Brian? His head's really tucked in there. I'm just making some space for Abel to come in behind us. Now, of course, you don't really want to stroke a leopard to feel its fur. Even though they look so pretty and clean, they are not. Lots of ticks, ectoparasites, mites, and also very strong possibility of getting tapeworms, liver flukes. So if you ever do handle a leopard, it's always best to wear gloves. Now, the wind is coming from the south, which is from behind that termite mound. So he's got that little ridge there that's protecting him from the wind. Nice little warm spot. Samson's wondering, where does quarantine male leopard fit in the dynamics of the other leopards? So he's Karula's last successful litter, so before these current cubs. And she had one other litter in between that was unfortunately killed by hyenas. So this is her last successful litter. She had 2 boys. And from a leopard dynamic, they could be born to a male up in the north, or they could be born to Mvula, or they could even be born to Tingana. Karula's probably mated with all 3 of those at that stage. Well, I think there was another male leopard around, but that was before my time. But it's very, very difficult to guess who the male leopard is without the genetics. So the only way to tell a leopard's father is actually to do genetic tests. And there is an ongoing study, so hopefully in the next year or so we will find out who exactly is daddy dearest to Quarantine, Konuma, and some of the other leopards around here. I see, even though he's an absolutely flat cat, his ear does a little pan around, like a little radar dish, seeing if he can pick up the sound of any creatures. Morning, Alice in Oregon. Alice is wondering, which is the most acute sense in a leopard? Is it eyesight? Is it smell? Is it hearing? I would have to say it's probably hearing and eyesight. And smell, they're very good, all their senses. Now, their sight works a little bit differently from the way ours do. They don't see the detail that we do, and they also only see in gray. So their eyes are sort of designed to pick up movement rather than detail. So
But their hearing is also exceptional.
Probably find out of those three senses, smell's probably the most, well, the least prominent of the three, even though a leopard can probably smell 25 times better than we can. Doug is in Connecticut. Doug would like to know, are ticks still a problem for the animals in the winter? They are, Doug. And you might not get as many ticks around as in the summer months, but they, especially not so much with leopards and lions as a problem, but with your herbivores like buffalo and zebra, impala, especially in a drought, the tick infestations can be very bad. And specifically because the animals or the herbivores are not as in good a condition as they would be in the summer months, those ticks can actually have quite an adverse effect. And we have seen a couple of impalas that have had tick infestations around their necks and stuff, and you can see them start losing condition. But while we sit here waiting for the quarantine male to get up and be a slightly more interesting than he is at the moment, Steph's got another little creature to show you.
And of course, as Murphy would have it, that little creature disappears behind some bushes as we come across. But we'll try and show it to you again. It's a steenbuck, another steenbuck. Seems like that's the only thing I'm good at finding today. We're going to see if we can get a little bit in front of him. Not quite as big as that male was from yesterday. I mean, from earlier this morning. Excuse me, what am I saying? And you can see, have a look at those little pointy horns. The larger they are, the closer to equal to the ear's length they will be. Now, hang on, wait. There you go, it's going to come out. There we go. No, stop. Obviously feeling rather exposed in the open areas, and for good reason. Even eagles, the martial eagle, will feed on steenbuck. Martial eagle, python, leopard, jackal, wild dog, lion, cheetah, caracal. I don't know if a serval will take a steenbuck. So we've got 8 predators that feed on those little steenbuck. I don't think if I was a steenbuck, I'd ever stop running. I'd run from bush to bush and hole to hole. Talking about holes, steenbuck have been known to give birth in ant bear holes or even hyena dens, disused or discarded hyena dens. And they do that so that they can stay hidden. Their best defense is to either run away with much agility or to just stay out of the way of predators. And quite often they have a technique of lying down as flat as what they can be. And I've watched lion and leopard and cheetah walk straight past steenbuck, who are just lying dead flat in the grass. A few of you may have seen over the months and years that we've been doing this particular show, steenbuck burying their dung. And that's another one of these techniques to minimize their smell or to minimize their presence in an area, is they will quite often scrape sand over their dung and over their urine to mask its smell, give birth in holes if it's available, if the holes are available, not exclusively, but if it's available, and then to stay as hidden as what they can. And if they do get found, they jink like crazy things. They're really very agile, I must be honest. As you can see from our shadow starting to come out in front of the vehicle, the sun has started to come out, although I may have spoken a little bit prematurely. Boyd, all the way from North Carolina, good morning, Boyd, has asked me, has it ever snowed in our area here? And if not, how far would I have to travel to get to snow? Boyd, I remember snow once, seeing snow on top of Maripskop, which is the highest point in the Drakensberg mountain range, quite close to where we are now. Roughly about 50 miles directly west of where we are now is Maripskop, and on top of Maripskop, I remember seeing snow probably around about 2004, 2003, somewhere around there. The Drakensberg does get snow, and the center of our country does get snow on the highest points. But there's an enormous kudu there. I'll go forward a little bit for you. Have a look at that guy. Isn't that one of the most majestic of the antelope? That's one of our largest antelope. It's a full-grown male kudu. And I know he's full-grown, almost full-grown, by having a look at the tips of his horns. Those horns, they are almost parallel to one another, just the horn tips. Still facing slightly in, but he's now a 5 or 6 year old male kudu. Definitely considered an adult. And have a look at how beautiful that is. Joey, you've asked me all the way from Australia, what are the main kudus what are the main predators of the kudus? It has to be lion. Lion are the only predators large enough to take on an animal that weighs 500 kilograms, 250 kilograms, about 500 pound. I have seen large male leopard take young kudu, but a full-grown male kudu like this generally only will be susceptible to lion. On the odd occasion, and in some areas, you do get hyena that will also take down kudu, but they will almost always have to do it in a group. But a one-on-one contest, only a lioness and a male lion are large enough to take down a kudu on a one-on-one contest. Leopard will take young kudu, wild dog and hyena will take kudu, but only when they're in a group. As you can see, he's got his face in a bush, and that's because he eats leaves. He's a browser. Now, they have a very varied diet. Kudu eat around about 150 different species of plant. The only animal that eats more or has a more diverse diet to a kudu is an elephant. I have a look. Perhaps if he does it for us again, when he eats, it's a bizarre characteristic of those horns, but the kudu can actually see its horn tip with its eye. Now, it doesn't look like that, but we may be lucky at this angle. You may be able to see when he turns his head like that, if we get a shot down the corkscrew of his horn, it's just at a very particular angle, but there's a tunnel that is generated by that corkscrew, similar to how you're looking down there. We can almost get it on the right-hand side horn. And funnily enough, if you put your eye on the point of his horn and you look down this tunnel, his full eyeball is visible. So that kudu can actually see where his horn tip is. And that's very good for when they are fighting with one another. He needs to be able to place his horns carefully when they are jousting with one another. But also, it's good in hooking branches. Kudus can hook branches with those enormous corkscrew horns and bring the branch down to mouth level, so therefore extending the levels at which they can feed. A very handy thing, that horn, unless you're running away, of course, then those things just get in the way and bash against every bush and branch. Now he's busy feeding on what looks to be a guari bush. Oh, a monkey orange. I think it's a tall monkey orange. There he comes out. I was about to say, he's not going to carry on with that for much longer, that's for sure. Shame. You know, I've started to notice the kudu's hip bones. If you have a look at his hip bone on the left-hand side of your screen there, coming into the middle, You'll see, although he's not skinny just yet, that cooties are starting to show signs of a little bit of malnutrition. Welcome, Brian. You're a new viewer, and we have to say welcome to the show. If you've been watching for a while and are only sending your first question through now, congratulations. If you have just joined us, a very warm welcome to you. You asked a question, how do I tell the difference between a Nyala and a Kudu? Their size is different, for one. A Nyala is about half the size of a Kudu, and they have a different colored coat. A Nyala has a reddish coat, and a Kudu has a gray coat. They still have those stripes and the dapples on them, but their colors, the size and the color would be the first indicator. As you then get a little bit closer, or you afforded a little bit of a better view, male Nyala have a dark chocolate brown coat that's very long, the fur is very long, and females have this rusty colored coat. But once again, much smaller than an adult kudu would be. Let's go around the corner here. This male kudu is actually in association with a few females. And I'll show you what the females look like, if we can, if they haven't managed to walk away from us in the interim. I can see one in front of us here. Let's go there. And you'll notice the dimorphism between the males and the females. In this particular group of animals, the spiral horned antelope, the males have horns and the females do not. And here we have a young male and a female and a young calf. See if we can get them all into shot for you. There we go. Oh, just pushed my luck a little bit too far there. You see that white fluffy tail that comes up? You may have just caught a flash of it. Sorry, Dave. We're just busy searching just to the left of that tree in the back there. All right, now we try and search. Sorry, I chased away the kudu over there. And while we try and find some more things to show you, we're going to send you across to Brent with quarantine.
Quarantine and Brian and myself have not moved a muscle. We're still sitting next to the termite mound. I am hoping he might get up and get moving at some point, maybe go for a drink at 3 in a row pan, or even just pop his head up so we can see his pretty face. He is very, very, very still at the moment. A sandblaster. That sandblaster is wondering, why is a leopard spots like that? What does it do? How does it help them? You can't see anything plant-wise in the African bush that looks like that. Well, it's not to mimic something, it's to break the outline. So if it was in the shade or even moving through the bush, those spots break the physical outline, making it more difficult for the prey species to see them. And if we look, cheetah also have those black spots to help break their outline. Lion cubs have lots of spots when they're being hidden by their mother to break the outline. What do you see, Brian?
No, nothing.
Oh. And so it's more to break out the outline. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask Brian to go back there. Now, just stop here, Brian. You can barely see him. And that's because of those spots. And if we go even a bit wider, you notice how he disappears, he blends into the termite mound. And that's because there's no one solid color. You can see there's different colors, the little grass, the little darker pieces of soil. So those spots are to help break the outline and help him disappear in the bush.
we had some movement. Sandy's wondering, how big is Anderson compared to Quarantine? Quite a lot bigger. I mean, he's one of the biggest leopards I've ever seen. I guess him to be around 90 kilograms, just over 200 pounds. I'd say Quarantine's probably not 150 pounds yet. So he's still got quite a bit of growing to do. Now, he definitely looks more comfortable than we are, because we're right in the wind and he's got his little nook there to hide from the wind. So while we sit here hoping for this big cat to get moving, let's go to Steph, who's got the biggest mammal in the world.
Not quite the biggest mammal in the world. I'd argue that whales are probably a bit bigger than elephant, but definitely the biggest land-based mammal in the world, the African elephant. Welcome back to me. It's Steph, if you've just joined us. Now we're on Juma Private Game Reserve here in the Kruger National Park with some elephant, a herd of elephant. Now this herd of elephant would all be related to one another and headed up by that big female that you see in the top left-hand corner of your screen. She's what we call the matriarch. And matriarchs are all mommies. A patriarch is a daddy that is in charge of a herd. In this particular instance, elephants are headed up by a female, and here is a mommy and a baby. It's a young female, this, with a young calf. That little calf is probably around about 6 months old, maybe a little bit less than 6 months. And I would say that it's this female's first baby. She's quite small. She is probably as big as a minivan, and that's in elephant terms for quite small. With that baby being about as big as, what can I say this baby is about as big as? Probably about as big as a full-grown sheep or a goat. Now what we're going to do is just sit very still. We've got the female approaching us. What we don't want to do is make her feel uncomfortable with our presence. We don't want to worry her in any way. She's got lots of avenues to walk in. What we want to do is give her the benefit of the doubt. Let's see where she goes. Now, elephants in the Kruger National Park, elephants in the Sabi Sands are quite tolerant of vehicles. They're not all tolerant of vehicles. I see she's actually damaged her trunk at the tip of it. She hasn't got those characteristic two fingers. Hello there, Mom. And that would be diagnostic. Hello, little guy. Hello. Very inquisitive, sticking his nose out. So that trunk of that mother that's only got no fingers at the tip, it's been damaged in a fire, or it was bitten, or something happened to it. That would be diagnostic firstly, and apparently we see her quite often on drive. I think I've seen her once or twice before. She uses that trunk less like fingers, but more like a club to hook vegetation. And as you can see, I mean, she's young calf, doing good. She's in good shape. Oh, look at that. Tail up, a little bit uncertain. Before I start my engine, I just want to let them get a little bit further away. I don't want to give her a big fright. Let's see, there she goes. Now we can start the car and get into a bit of a better angle to see her with. And Elaine has asked me if elephants ever have twins. Elaine, they do, and it's not uncommon for twins to happen right where we are at the moment. In actual fact, a gentleman called Richard Sowry has recorded twins on a specific elephant every time she has babies. But it is quite uncommon in elephant around the world. I have never ever seen an elephant with twins myself. Even though it is recorded here, it wouldn't be a very common thing to see. Generally, they just have one baby. And it's because elephants are pregnant for 24 months. And for all of your 22 months at least, for all of you mommies out there who were pregnant for 9 months, and I know having shared the pregnancy with my wife for 9 months, 9 months is 1 year too long. Can you imagine being pregnant for 22 months? That's what these mothers have to endure. And that's because the baby elephant must come out able to walk and function as a miniature version of an adult, basically. Mommies can't carry them around. Now have a look at the way this elephant is using her damaged trunk. Elephants can only afford to lose the use of three of their appendages. They have to have their feet, they have to have their trunk, and they have to have their ears. The loss of any one of those three is fatal for elephant. Now, while she hasn't lost the use of her trunk, she's lost the two fingers at the tip of her trunk. That doesn't look too bad, in actual fact. She's managing quite all right. Her calf is healthy, which means that she's still producing milk. Justin, you've asked me a nice question here. Would milk from an elephant taste any different to the milk from a cow? Whew. Justin, I actually can't answer that question, to be honest with you. I don't know the fat content of elephant milk. I would imagine it's quite high, but I wouldn't be able to answer that question, to be quite honest with you. I don't actually know. I've never tasted the milk, elephant milk before. But if you want, you're welcome to research that, or any of you out there, you're welcome to research the answer to that question. And I'll share it with everybody. You can send your thoughts or your answers to questions at wildearth.tv or the hashtag Safari Live. And I'll try and share it before the end of drive if we have some answers to that. Well, the question again, does elephant milk taste different to cow's milk? And I would wager that the answer would come in trying to find a comparison in the fat content. Now this time of year, elephants are doing what they're doing now, feeding slowly through the bush toward water and from water for roughly about 18 to 24 hours a day. The bush is providing very little in terms of nutrients at the moment. And so to get enough nutrients, these elephants are needing to feed a lot. Now look at this young guy. He's now moved a branch out of the way and is now picking up bits and pieces of material underneath that branch. So that tells me that he is 6 months old. The reason I say that is that elephants only really get quite dexterous with their trunks at about 6 months old. Younger than that, elephant trunks tend to just be these floppy appendages that get in the way most of the time. And that young elephant definitely displayed some dexterity with his trunk. And that female goes using that club-like trunk to push trees into her mouth. It's just something pretty timeless when we're sitting with a herd of elephant that is as relaxed as what these are. For some reason, elephants sort of embody the African continent for me. And Christopher, all the way from Arizona. Good evening, Christopher. You've asked quite a nice question. Do elephants get sick with the flu like we do, or cold? And if so, would their trunk run? Christo, they are susceptible to a very wide variety of different diseases, elephant. I don't know if they catch the common flu like we would. They probably do get sick. I've seen elephant trunks running before, but I don't know if it was from a cold or whether it was from some irritation. I would probably say they can catch some type of flu, probably unique to elephant. But as do they catch a human flu, I would probably say no to that specific virus, but definitely they will be susceptible to viruses. I have a page somewhere in some of my research material which lists the different diseases that elephant can get, and it runs into a couple of dozen. Well, you're busy having a look at that young elephant again, around about six months old, plus minus, using his trunk to pick up some stuff, and obviously trying to stand on his back leg. I don't know what he's trying to do there. He's got some thorns probably under his feet. They are so comical, these young guys. And a good morning to all of you at Rodine that have just joined us. Mrs. Gonzalez class and Miss Funamava, welcome, welcome. There we go. You don't want to be looking at the back of my head. You are on safari with us. I just want to say good morning to you. Hopefully it has been a good morning for you so far. It's been an exceptional morning for us so far. The sun is not beating down and burning us to a crisp, and it's not that cold, which is a good thing. Unlike where you are, I'm sure. We've got some elephant with us at the moment. There's a baby elephant with them, and we are just busy watching this young elephant take some thorns out of his feet. Now, I did mention, you may have caught it, that I think that this elephant is about 6 months old, and the reason why I'm saying that is because he can use his trunk. Elephants only start to use their trunk at about 6 months. Before that, their trunks are just these floppy arms that come out of the top of their faces, or the middle of their faces. Now, I want you to do something. I want you to grab your top lip and your nose at the same time, and I want you to pull them out as far as you can. So you're going to grab your top lip and your nose with your one hand, and you're going to pull it out as far as you can. And that is a trunk. I'm going to show you. You do this, and you pull that. And that is a trunk of an elephant. That is where the trunk comes from. It's an elephant's top lip and nose, and pulled out. And it's got two fingers at the bottom that are made from the tip of their nose and the tip of their trunk. And they can use that to pick up things in the bush and put it in their mouths. Isn't that amazing? Did you all get that right? Hopefully without getting too much stuff on your fingers. Now this is one family. That's the mommy elephant that you're having a look at. And that was her baby that we were with the moment. And they are going to be feeding into that thick bush. We can't go into that thick bush. We will get a puncher. And I can't carry this Land Rover on my back. All right, but we're going to send you over to Brent. He's got a little surprise just for you.
Look at this. Welcome, Rodine. We've got another leopard. You guys seem to give me all the leopard luck. Now, I've found out that not only do we know Mia. Oh, guys, look at this. We've got a leopard, and just behind us, I'll say hello to everyone now, we've got a massive herd of elephants. So, welcome, and that male leopard's going to try to keep as still as possible so the elephants don't see him. If they find him, they're going to chase him, and he looks very comfortable. So, what an exciting start to your live game drive, guys. And I know you guys are studying habitats, and we're in a completely different habitat to where we were yesterday. Now, leopards are the most adaptable of the big cats and can live in lots of different habitats. They can live from forests to deserts to mountains, along the rivers. Oh, he's going back to sleep. He doesn't think the elephants are going to spot him. Some of the Ellies are having a drink, so let's go have a look at the Ellies. I don't think the leopard's going to move. Now, I found out that not only do we know Mia and Gracie in your class, someone else in your class, his dad is a very good friend of mine. So a big hello to Savannah Morley. Hi Savannah, I hope you're having fun on the game drive. I know how much you love game drives. So here we go. And that's the best thing about being out in the bush. You never know what's going to come around the next corner. So we were sitting with a leopard and a big herd of elephants suddenly snuck up on us. Hi Sienna. Sienna would like to know how big or how long is an elephant's trunk. So it all depends on the size of the elephant. A big male elephant, its trunk can be nearly 2 meters long. A female like that one there, from the top of her nose, down is probably, what do you say, Brian, 1.5, 1.6 meters? But there's a male there, and he's still a young male, but his trunk, you can see, is much longer. Now, you can see this is a very, very different habitat to what the one we were in yesterday. We were in a little river system yesterday. Now we're on a crest. So there's some water here, and that's what's bringing the elephants and bringing the leopard here. But we'll have a look at the habitat a bit more carefully. The trees are going to be very, very different in this habitat to the one we were in yesterday. Hello, mister. Now, the wind is quite strong today, so the elephants sometimes aren't very relaxed when there's strong wind. Oh, that's a young boy. So what he might do is he might walk up to us, he might shake his head. Oh, he's going to spray some water in our direction. That's what he thinks of us this morning. But please don't wet us. It's very cold here today. I'm sure you guys are nice and cold in Joburg as well. Hopefully your classroom is nice and warm. Oh. Watch his behavior. He's not very relaxed in this wind, but he's going to move away from us. Okay. Now we're going to look at the habitat around us. Now, yesterday, the habitat we're in was nice and green. And if we look at this habitat here, you can see it's very, very different. The trees are much smaller, and you can see they're all getting their losing their leaves as we go deeper into winter. The sand here is got a, well, it's more sandy here, not so clay based. And you can see how the elephants have changed the habitat around here. We talked about how elephants are one of the animals that are able to change their environment. So you can see because there's water here, the elephants have opened up the area close to the water. They've eaten a lot of the trees. But they've also put a lot of fertilizer down, and you can see there's lots of elephant fertilizer everywhere. And so elephant dung all over the place. Now we'll go back to that leopard, although he's still very much asleep in this cold weather. And he's got himself a really nice little spot there. So the wind is coming from here, and he's got himself a little hole in the top of that termite mound where he's protected from the wind, where he can snooze and be nice and toasty, much toastier than us. Oh, Colt's asked a very interesting question. Hi, Colt. Colt would like to know, why do leopards have white bellies? Now, that is a very interesting question, because as you can see, the rest of their body is covered in those spots to try and make sure that other animals can't see them. And those elephants walked straight past here and didn't see that leopard on top of the termite mound. The reason they have white bellies is possibly because they can absorb or dispel heat. So even though it's cold now, you can see the leopard's curled in a little ball. But when it is very hot, they tend to lie with their legs open. So white reflects heat, and all the big cats don't like the heat that much. Even though they live in hot places, they tend to try and move around when it's cool. So the white belly of a lion or a leopard is going to reflect the heat a little bit, so try to keep them a little bit cooler. although he doesn't need to reflect heat this morning, it's very chilly. Now he's tucked up into a little ball. This is a different leopard from the one we saw yesterday. It was a big male we saw yesterday. This is a young male. So he's about to start his life being a daddy, where the male we saw yesterday has just ended being a daddy. Now, we've just had all those beautiful elephants walk past us, and Michaela is wondering, how fast can an elephant run? Faster than the fastest man on earth. They can run up to about 50 kilometers an hour, so much faster than a person, and they can keep it up for a lot longer of a distance. So they can probably keep that up for a couple of hundred meters. Now, of course, a leopard is faster than an elephant, but a leopard is faster for a shorter time. Now, a leopard does about 24 meters per second when they're at top speed, which is just under 90 kilometers an hour. But they only keep that up for a very, very short space of time. Now, that's because they are ambush predators. Now, what makes leopards so unbelievably adaptable and able to utilize so many different habitats is their hunting strategy, and they can be very, very patient. Now he's in a good spot here because there's water right behind us, so there's a chance that an impala or a little duiker or a stenbok, which are the most common antelope in this habitat, or and kudu as well, might come for a drink and might not see him on that termite mound because he's so flat there that he might be able to find himself some dinner, or in this case, breakfast. Now remember yesterday we talked about habitats not only being the big things. So the leopard is actually lying on a habitat itself. It is a termite mound. Now if we come out a little bit, you can see it's a very big one. And it is still an active one. If you go, you see the open chimney there, Brian? So now termites are farmers, so they're actually another animal that can make their own habitat. So they build these fantastically large termite mounds, and they open and close these chimneys to keep it at about 32 degrees Celsius, because that's the perfect temperature to farm fungus, which is like mushrooms, and that's their favorite food. So there's another habitat, and because of the termite mounds, other animals also use them. As you can see, leopard and lion like to lie on top of them. It gives them a nice high spot to check around. Also, other animals like snakes and scorpions and spiders will also live on termite mounds. And one of the strangest little creatures out in the African bush also lives on a termite mound. It's called an African thief ant. Now, it's a type of ant that is so tiny you need a magnifying glass or a microscope to see most of the workers. And the reason they like to live on the side of termite mounds is their favorite food is baby termites. But they're so small, the termites can't see them. So they go into the termite mounds and carry the baby termites away back to their little mound, which will be on the side of the termite mound, and then they can eat the baby termites. But they're so small that the soldier termites who are there to protect the babies can't even see them. Hi, Shania. Shania would like to know, oh, he's opened his eye. He's listening to you, Shania. He likes the sound of your name. Panaya, sorry. Likes the sound of your name. Oh, or has he heard something else? Are we going to get another bunch of elephants appear behind us? But a leopard has a white tip to its tail. It's called a following mechanism. It's more for female leopards when they have babies, that they're able to see mom's tail go through the bush. So, because leopards see in black and white. So things that are dark, blacks, like black behind a leopard's ears, and the white tip of the tail, they're going to be able to see a lot more easily, and that makes it easier for the babies to follow the moms. Oh, Is he going to get up and get moving? Now, on both of our game drives, we've seen leopards sleeping. And Sophie would like to know, why do leopards sleep so much? Well, it looks like he might wake up for a little bit. Now, Sophie, they sleep so much because they have trouble dispelling heat, and that's why they have that white tummy again. Now, a leopard, on average, will sleep for about 18 hours a day. So what happens is they use so much energy when they hunt that they have to rest quite a lot. Otherwise, they're not going to be able to hunt again very soon. So when they sleep for 18 hours a day, it's not normally 18 hours in a row. They will get up and move and then sleep again and get up and move. But they don't sleep as much as lions. Now, the reason for that is they're a bit smaller, so they don't utilize as much energy as a lion when they move. Now, I'm hoping he stands up for us and goes out hunting. Wouldn't that be exciting? Now, even though he has been napping, he's very alert. Now, if you look at his ears, they're always moving around like little radar dishes, picking up all the sounds around him. And this is one of our favorite leopards. We haven't seen him in quite a long time, so it's quite exciting to see him. Isn't he just beautiful? Now, as I was saying about habitats, leopard of the big cats can live in the most different habitats. They've even been found, they found a frozen leopard on Mount Kilimanjaro in Tanzania, which is the highest mountain in Africa, and it looked like that leopard was right up in the snow line, and then he got caught by a snowstorm. Oh, it looked like he might have heard something there. Could there be some impala coming down for a drink? Could there be some stenbok coming down for a drink? Or has he heard the sound of a potential danger like a hyena or a lion or another big male leopard, because he's still quite young? We're going to wait here. Hopefully he moves soon. If he moves, we'll be right back. But while we do that, let's go across to Steph, who's got a male leopard's favorite food.
That's exactly right. We've got a male leopard's favorite food, and that's impala. This is a male impala, and look how beautiful he is. But what you can't see from this particular angle, which we're going to try and show you now, is he's had an accident. He's been in a fight with another male impala, and he's blind in his one eye. Those horns are so sharp, if you had to put your finger on top of that horn and push down really hard, it'll make you bleed. I want to show you what's happened. Let's see if we can get you a little bit closer to this guy. You can see they're busy eating leaves at the moment. They normally eat grass, but because we're in winter, they're eating leaves as well. Let's see if we can get you a bit closer to this male. He's been fighting with another male, and I think he's hurt his eye in a fight. Let's see, there you go. Have a look at that. You can see his eye is looking quite sore. Now that would be because they bump heads together when they fight. And I think what's happened over there is the one horn has gone into the other one's eye. That's going to be a pity. And now we've got some kudu on the side. Looks like we're finding all the stuff on this road, hey? Coming down. It's a kudu and a warthog, in actual fact. Let's go forward a little bit. Hello there. Two warthogs. See the tail up? Got a nice story to tell you about warthog. When warthogs were made, there were not enough skin, and their skin is very, very tight. And so what happens is when they run through the bush, they have to close their eyes because all the sticks go into their face. And because they're closing their eyes tight, their skin pulls tight and their tails come up. But because they can't see where they're going, they have to stop running. And then they look around and their tails go down when their eyes open again. And we'll see now. We'll see. Let's see if this warthog. There you go. See? Oh, not quite. There's a female warthog. I'm going to teach you how to tell males from females right now. Have a look at her face. You see underneath her eyes, she's got a wart there. There she sees, tail up, eyes closed, eyes open, tail down. Let's go forward a little bit and see if I can show you that again. All right, let's go in here. All right, so this one is a young male. You're going to have a look at the warts that he's got underneath his eye, but also by his big tusk. There's another wart there. You see he's got two warts under his eye and by his mouth. That's a male. Females only have the one wart under the eye. Yeah, you see she's running there, tail's up. Now she'll stop because she can't see where she's going. Tail down. See there? Right, that's a warthog. Warthog in their skin that's pulled a little bit too tight. Ooh, Jordan, you've asked me how far an impala can walk in a day. Not that far, Jordan. They don't like to go further than about 5 kilometers from water. So that's the maximum distance that an impala will walk from water. I don't think that they walk much more than a kilometer or two every day. They walk slowly through the bush, eating the bushes that they can get through, the grass and the plants that they get to eat. They like to drink water every day, and then they move back to where they've got some grass. So not that far. Have a look at this. There's a warthog digging on its knees there. Still these same two warthogs that we were with. Quite often they go down on their knees. Oh, there we go, sorry. Potty break. I must be honest with you, they have to be one of the ugliest animals that I've ever seen. Definitely were not blessed with all the good looks. And they're in the bush here with some kudus. And now you'll see the kudus have got these enormous ears. They're like radar dishes. Now I want you to try something. I want you to try and cup your hands around your ears like kudus do. I want you to do this today. And yes, it's going to make you look very, very silly, like it does to me, but try as much as you can. You'll see that you will hear much better with your hands cupped behind your ears like this in one direction. And that's exactly what those kudus are doing. They've got these huge trumpet or bell-shaped ears that allow them to hear much better. And you can try that today. Try it on your playing field or wherever you're going to be. Listen to some people far away and then cup your ears. Oh, we've got a big male kudu with these females. Let's see if we can go and show you him. Let's go there. A male kudu have huge horns. Aaron, you've just asked me, why do elephants have such big ears? Aaron, completely different to kudu. They have such big ears. Look at this big kudu running across. There we go. He's now run off after his females. Completely different, Aaron. Kudus have their big ears to help them to hear better in the bush. Elephants have their big ears to help them cool down. An elephant pushes all the blood in its body into its ears and then flaps its ears in the breeze. And that cools the blood down and helps them to keep their temperature normal. I don't know if it's the same when you get sick, but my mom always used to put a thermometer in my mouth or in my ear to test my temperature. And we have a temperature of 37 degrees centigrade. Elephants also have a temperature, and they can't go below or above that temperature. We are warm-blooded animals, which means we have to stay at the same temperature. And when elephants get too hot, they can die and they can get sick. And so they pump the blood in their ears and they flap them from side to side. Now, I haven't quite learned how to flap my ears yet, but I've got ears almost as big as an elephant, and they definitely help me to stay cool. Because I tell you, in weather like you having in Johannesburg at the moment, my ears are the first thing to get cold. But on that little note, we're going to send you over to Brent with that male leopard that you've got.
So he popped his head back down and went fast to sleep again. Now, as I said, it's a good spot for him. There's water just behind us, so there's quite a good chance that he might get some breakfast. Hi, Savannah. Savannah wants to know, why do leopards have whiskers? Now, there's quite a few different reasons why an animal would have a whisker. And in leopard's case, they can actually pick up vibrations and things with that. And specifically, he might be able to feel something through there. But there are sensory organs, so there's a whole bunch of nerves. And unfortunately, we don't understand as much about those whiskers as we would like to. So there are some people much smarter than us who are looking into it. But my understanding is they can pick up certain vibrations, and it helps them as a sort of early warning system if they're in danger or with prey around. So very, very interesting stuff, but we don't know as much as we think we do sometimes about the animals out here. And that's one of the amazing things about spending so much time with them, is that you learn new things every single day. And we might, I think while he's sleeping like this, we might move around. We're going to come back to him. Nina's asking a very interesting question, because the two spotted cats we have are the leopard and the cheetah. So we'll wait a second before we leave him snoozing and go have a look at a different habitat that's down here, because we're in a different area to where we were yesterday. So Nina's saying, besides the tear marks, how do you tell the difference between a leopard and a cheetah? Well, we have a look at him. He's got rosettes, so he doesn't really have proper spots. So try and move a little bit closer so Brian can zoom. You can see there's sort of three darker spots, sometimes four, with a sort of orangish in the middle. But when we look at a cheetah, now if we look at the skin of a cheetah, there we go. It's just, how's that, Brian? Am I holding it right angle? Sorry, the light is very bad today, guys. It's very overcast. There we go. Now you can see a cheetah's just got single spots. Also, their body shape is very different. Cheetah are taller than leopard, but they weigh less. So they've got to weigh less because they've got to run faster for longer. So a leopard is an ambush predator, so they'll pounce out of the bush very quickly and run for a very short time. Whereas a cheetah will often run for more than 100 meters, a leopard will very seldom run for longer than 20 meters. So he's snoozing, and those elephants have gone. So we're going to move around. There's a very interesting habitat just down the road that is very, very different from where we are now. And you guys are studying habitats. As nice as it to see all the big cats, we'd be able to show you some different habitats we have out here. So we will come back before the end to have a look there. So we were sitting in a big river system, well, not a big river system, a little dry river system yesterday, which is a habitat that lots of different animals like, and different animals that like this area up on the crest. So here is what the beginning of one of those river systems looks like. And you can see how green the trees are all of a sudden as it starts going down here. So this is a little valley between two of that, and you can see all the trees are still green right here. Now that's because there's water underneath the ground here, so that's why all the trees are green. But all these habitats mix into each other, so They actually work together to a degree. So now during the winter months, these habitats where there's lots of green, the elephants like to eat there, and they put a lot of pressure on these areas. But then once it's rainy in the summer, the elephants tend to feed more up on the crest where it's going to be green on this side, and it takes the pressure off the little river systems. But we're going to go show you a big open habitat, and we were just talking about cheetah, and this is the best place where we drive around to see cheetah. So they prefer a more open habitat where they can see further, and they can utilize that incredible speed without tripping over a stick. Hi Shana. Shana's wondering what kind of animals could kill a leopard. Well Shana, there's quite a few. Leopard are quite good at getting away, but hyenas, if they manage to get hold of them, lions are probably the animals that are the most dangerous for a leopard. But then again, also an animal like an elephant could kill a leopard if it caught it. A buffalo, and even a rhino if they manage to catch it. But leopards are very quick and they can also climb trees. So the main threat to leopards, apart from human beings, is lions. So we're working our way through a crest here, and from the crest we're going to go out into some big open plains, and who knows, fingers crossed, there might be cheetah there. Also, we might see some other animals like zebra, wildebeest, who prefer the more open areas. Here in this mixed woodland, we're going to find duiker, steenbok, kudu, sometimes waterbuck, sometimes impala, and lots of squirrels. Although on a windy, cold morning like this, all the squirrels are still snug in their holes in the trees. While we go to the big open plains, let's go see what Steph's up to on the other side of the reserve.
Welcome back. You just caught myself in a little bit of a question that I've posed for myself. I want to know how old termite mounds can get. I'm going to show you right here. There's a clue for you. That is obviously a very big, very old tree. And that tree is 200 or 300 years old. Can you imagine that? Now have a look at the base of that tree. This will give you the clue. That tree is obviously growing on top of that termite mound. The termite mound is not growing through the tree. That tree is on top of the termite mound. And this is where the answer will be for most of you. How old do you think that termite mound is? Older than 200 or 300 years. Isn't that amazing? Now what the scientists don't know is whether or not the termite colony that lives inside that termite mound is also 200 or 300 years old. What they think is two different things. Either it is or it isn't. And if it isn't, they think that a termite mound is recolonized. That means it's occupied by different colonies of termites over hundreds of years. We don't know the answers to those questions just yet. And isn't it amazing that even though we can be so clever, we can send people to the moon, we can send spaceships to Mars, but we don't know how old a termite mound actually is or what goes on inside a termite mound right here in our backyards. Incredible, hey? All right, now I'm on my way. I'm on my way to go and have a look and see if we can see some stinky buffalo close to our camp. There's this old group of buffalo bulls that live there. But while I'm doing that, Mary Ann, you've asked me what do termites eat. The termites that live inside that termite mound we were just having a look at, Mary Ann, eat mushrooms. They eat fungus. and they grow these mushrooms themselves deep down inside that termite mound, deep in the ground, close to the water. Termites farm mushrooms. Isn't that amazing? They are farmers. Then you get other termites that are not farmers. Those are the harvester termites. On your school field, especially this time of the year, the dark black termites that come out of the ground and collect all the grass, those are harvester termites. Those have tiny little animals that live inside their bellies that eat that grass. But can you imagine that? They have a whole number of animals that live inside their tiny little bellies that eat the grass, and then they eat those animals. Isn't that amazing? Hey, one animal living in another that helps it eat the grass that grows in its mouth, and then they eat them. And of course, this is a cycle, so it's natural and normal for it to do that. It's easier if you draw a picture, really, to try and understand it for yourself. So you get two different types of termites, two different things that they eat, two different ways that they eat it. Alrighty, now we're going to be having a look for these stinky buffaloes. Buffaloes, for me, I love looking at buffaloes, but they just generate the most amazing amount of flies on them. And flies are not my best friend. Let me just put it to you that way. I can feel them tickling my head when I'm close to these buffaloes. And of course, having no hair, I've got a lot of head all over the place. Now, why do I know that these buffalo will probably be around the water? They drink lots of water. They can't be far away from water. And the only water that I know, and we're putting it together, and we're making a puzzle as to how we can find these animals. And putting all those pieces together is what takes all the time and what we went to school for to learn how to become game rangers. It takes a long time to do that. I've been at school for being a game ranger now for almost 17 years, and that was after I finished school like you did. Can you imagine? Long time, eh? I think Brent has got an update for you.
So we're talking about different habitats, and here we have a massively different habitat. You can see very few trees, very short grass, and we find different animals in different habitats. And this particular habitat is a favorite of the wildebeest. And there's a big herd of wildebeest in the distance there. There they are. And just behind them are some zebra. Now, it's not uncommon to find wildebeest and zebra together. But I see some a bit closer to us, so we're going to go to those. Now, wildebeest and zebra have very different diets. They both eat grass, but they eat very differently. A zebra is what you call a bulk grazer. So it just munches. It doesn't really matter what it munches, and it munches through. Now, wildebeest are a bit fussy. So they only like grass species that are very short and at certain lengths. So the zebras will quite often now eat the grass and keep it nice and short, and then the wildebeest can go pick which grasses he likes in between. Now, another strange creature we might find on these open plains that we see from time to time here is ostriches. And of course, cheetah. This is all very good area for those animals. And you can see, I haven't traveled more than a couple of kilometers, and we're in a completely different habitat already. Now, not to say that the other animals won't use the habitats. They've got to sometimes walk through them between the different habitats. But normally, you'll find wildebeest and zebra prefer the more open areas. And here we go. Here's some zebra up ahead. Now, these look like the boys with no girlfriends, two young boys. And a big daddy wildebeest. by, guys. Now, the big daddy wildebeest will keep an area like this. So this is a wildebeest we've named. His name is Gnormalus Gnorman the Gnu. Hello, Gnormalus. And this is his territory. So the females will move in and out of the territories between the different males, and the males will stay in one spot, and he'll defend it against any other boys who want to come here. And the reason this is such a good wildebeest territory is because of the short grass. It means it's going to attract the ladies. The ladies are visiting his enemy who lives on the other side of the clearing at the moment. And what he's doing there is he's defecating, but that means he's marking his territory. So letting all the other wildebeest know that this is his spot. And there's two young male zebra. So they're not big enough to go get any girlfriends. So you quite often will find young male zebra hanging around with a lone male wildebeest. Now, one of the reasons for this is the more eyes you have, the better chance you have of seeing the lion before it jumps on you. Very pretty. Well, off they go. And you can see how windy it is. Look at that dust going. Now, you have lots of species that will utilize multiple habitats. So in the summer months when the grass is longer here, you can find elephants here. And, well, we find buffalo quite often, big herds, up to 500 on the short grass. But the only normal resident in this habitat who's here all the time is that wildebeest. Hi, Chloe. Chloe's wondering how quick a zebra can run. Chloe can probably do up to about 60 kilometers an hour, and they can keep it up for a while. Oh, look at him. He's scent marking again. So he's got little glands on his feet and on his face that leave a smell. So when he's scraping his feet like that, that's what he's doing. If you ever see your dogs or your cats at home scraping their feet, they're marking their territory, saying that this is their spot. Oh, unfortunately, no cheetah here today. So I'm going to check around. There's another waterhole close by. And if there's nothing at that waterhole, then we'll go back to the leopard. Now, I was hoping for some birds here, but I think the wind is keeping them hunkered down. So while we go check around the next waterhole, Steph's got a big animal to show you.
Well, it's not quite the buffalo I wanted to show you, but have a look at this beautiful bull elephant, a male daddy elephant, and he's busy eating a buffalo thorn. Now I want you to hold out your baby finger. That is how long the thorns are that this elephant is busy putting in his mouth. Isn't that amazing? Doesn't get pricked. I'm sure he does, but he doesn't really feel it. Now, Amanda, you've asked me how long an elephant can live for. Amanda, the elephant in the Kruger National Park can live up to 60 years. 60 years, a long time, hey? Generally between 50 and 60 years. But in other places in Africa, elephants have been known to live up to 70 years. So they can get to 70 years old, but in this area, they get to 50 to 60 years old. And the reason why it's slightly less is because they eat all these trees here. It wears down their teeth, and when their teeth are finished, they can't eat anymore. Let me go forward a little bit. I just want to see if we can get a slightly better view of his head. Three here for you. And Adora has asked me, how big can an elephant grow? Now, Adora, the elephants in this area, in the Kruger National Park, they grow up to about 6,000 kilograms, 6 tons. That is about two of your mommy's cars that dropped you off today at school, about two cars. Normally cars are about 1.5 to 3.5 tons. A big car is about 3.5 tons and Ellie's get up to 6 tons. This particular elephant is probably around about 4 tons, 4,000 kilograms. Those tusks, if you stick out your leg as far as it can go, the tusk is as big from the tip of your toe all the way to your hip. Now he's using his nose. Michaela, you're asking me a question. Can an elephant, I'm not quite getting you, something with a human.
Can it kill a human?
Oh, can it kill a human? Yes, absolutely. The elephants are part of the Big Five, and the Big Five get their name from being the five most dangerous animals to walk up to on foot. And they absolutely include the elephant and that leopard you were looking at, and the buffalo we are looking for, and a rhinoceros and a lion. Those are the Big Five. And they are the five most dangerous animals to approach on foot. Although, I must be honest, I would add their hippo and crocodile absolutely to that list. Have a look at those teeth. Once again, that tooth is as long as from the tip of your toe all the way to your hip. That's as long as that tusk is, that tooth. This elephant has got two beautiful teeth. They're almost exactly the same size, which is uncommon. Most elephants have tusks that are looking different. This elephant has very symmetrical tusks. That means that they look the same. And he uses his tusks to fight with, and he uses his tusks to eat with, to break off branches, to help him break off branches. Sienna, you've asked me, can an elephant run faster than a hippo? Yes, Sienna, an elephant can absolutely run faster than a hippo. Elephants can run up to 45 kilometers an hour. Hippos are running at about 35 kilometers per hour. And that is still much, much faster than the fastest human being can run. So elephants can run up to 45 kilometers an hour. And hippo can run up to 35 kilometers per hour. And at the fastest, we have leopard. They run about 80 kilometers per hour. And lion, just slightly less than that, at about 75 to 80 kilometers per hour. And right in the middle of all of them is the buffalo. And a buffalo can run 55 kilometers per hour. Now have a look at that. That white secretion that's at the corner of his eye is not because he's just woken up and didn't wash his face this morning before having breakfast. That is a gel that covers the elephant's eyes to stop dust and sticks from hurting his eye. Let's see if we can go backwards a little bit and I'll show you that again. That elephant secretes that gel, and that gel stops the eye from hurting with sticks and dust. Let's see if we can show you that now. Got such a nice view of him. Have a look at that. So that's almost like an elephant eye wash or eye drop. And he's gonna maybe shake his head at us, I don't know. Yeah, you can see he's using that big trunk. His ears are coming out. Now remember what we said, an elephant's ears is used to cool down his blood. He pumps all the blood in his body through his ears every 20 minutes or so. And that is a lot of blood in those ears. Now have a look, his tusks. Can you see they are different colors? And those different colors come from all the juices from the plants that he feeds on, staining his ivory. And also from some mud and dirt. Mainly their tusks get that beautiful color from all the juices of the trees that they feed on. But the actual color of the ivory is an off-white color, almost pure white. Isn't he beautiful? Have a look at the tips of those trunks, of those tusks. Pointing straight towards us. I don't know what this elephant's going to do now. I'm going to push through these branches. Keeping an eye on us just to make sure that we don't... No. Why are you being naughty now? No, what are you going to do? No, boy. Come on. Here we go. Look how big you are. You're very big. Yes. No. Be nice. Thank you. Wow. That's scary. No. You be nice. Don't worry. We don't want you to push this tree over us. There you go. No need to get like that. Bye-bye. That was scary, eh? Big elephant wanting to touch the front of the car. You have to tell him no. Wanting to be naughty. What's his story here? He's all fine now, though. See that tail up? Now he's going to turn around. Shake his head. Oh, you're a big boy. Yes, you're the biggest elephant. Now with elephants, you keep on going to tell them about how big and scary they are. Otherwise, they want to show you how big and scary they are. It's always a good idea to carry on talking to elephant. They need to be told how beautiful they are. Now he's all relaxed, he's okay. He's just deciding what he wants to do. And he'll probably just go back to eating. There we go, trunk coming up. Now we've got some impala busy giving an alarm call. Just around the corner from where we are, and I think it's a good idea for us to go and have a look at what's making them upset. Goodbye, big guy. Thank you for letting us share your breakfast. Always a good idea to say thank you to elephants. They're very, very big and they can be very, very scary, and we've always got to watch out for them. But as long as you keep on telling them how nice they are, they'll be nice to you. Right now, what we are off to look for is right in this direction in front of us here. I can hear some impala giving a warning bark, as we call it. And they only really do that for predators, lion and leopard. And we've got both in this area, lion and leopard. There's a male leopard that likes to live here and a female leopard with two little babies that likes to live here. And there are also some lions that have been here recently. Last night they were busy hunting buffalo all around our camp. All right, and I think while we're having a look for these impala and whatever they're barking at, we're going to send you back to Brent, who's with that leopard that you started with.
Well, on our adventures, we saw some zebra, we saw some wildebeest. And we've come back, and fortunately, the leopard has decided not to move before we got back here. Oh, here comes a yawn. Oh, look at those teeth. Oh, they are such beautiful creatures. Now you can see the long whiskers. Oh, another yawn. Now, when big cats start yawning, there's a chance they might start moving. Ah, and a bit of licking. Oh, I think he just got bitten by a termite or something, or maybe even a scorpion. Something stung him and it made him jump to the other side of the termite mound. Oh, he's got something funny in his mouth. He could have a termite soldier biting his tongue. He looks very unimpressed with it. But there we go, he gave you a bit of action. Rodine, it's been fantastic having you with us, and hopefully we'll see you again soon. You bring such good luck, and now you get to meet the Thumb. So that's actually who controls the camera, not Brian, it's the Thumb. But been great having you. We're going to stick with this leopard, and maybe next time I'll tell you what happens after you guys go back to school. isn't this exciting? Quarantine. I think what happened is he got a termite soldier on his tongue, and he's looking quite unimpressed with that. Hello, Mr. Q. Oh, he is just a gorgeous leopard. How's that, Brian? Do you want me to go a little bit more forward? Oh, there's a stick in the way. I'm just going to go past it. There he is. Still licking his chops. I hope you guys are getting some fantastic screenshots. It's so wonderful to catch up with them again. Now, if this is, and what is Mr. Quarantine, he's true to form. There we go. He likes to pose for screenshots and photographs. He's looking very upset with whatever he ate. Another yawn coming. Hi, Marianne. Marianne's in Boston. Marianne says, Brent and Brian, do you remember when we found them sleeping on the bush dinner site? We definitely do. There's no ways we could forget that. Okay, on cue, Mr. Quarantine, look at the lens. Oh, no, he looked past the lens. And I actually think I might have a copy of that photograph with me. I'll see if I can find it and then show it to everyone. So what I think happened is he licked his foot like that, and I think there was a termite soldier on his foot. And it immediately clamped onto his tongue and gave him a bit of a fright. So it looks like he might go for a bit of a walk, and we're definitely going to hang around and not go anywhere, see where he goes. Hi, Shannon. Shannon's in Ohio. Shannon says, this might be a dumb question. No such thing. Shannon, only a dumb answer. Shannon wants to know, do they only sleep during the day, or do they sleep at night too? They do sleep at night as well as during the day, Shannon. So, depending on how full they are and lots of different things, but they will sleep at night as well. Now, I'm wondering if I have that picture. Hi, Crystal, who's in California. And Crystal's wondering, is there ever going to be a time when there just isn't enough space for a leopard to disperse? Well, I think we have reached that to a degree already, Crystal, and nice little rollover. And unfortunately, some male leopards are pushed into areas where they are not really welcome anymore. I'm hoping he doesn't head too far to the north. We'd much prefer him to stay right where he is. He does look like he's a little bit hungry. Okay. So we were chatting about that wonderful sighting we had of him sleeping on the bush dinner site. And I thought I had them here. And that's how we... There we go. Oopsie. I dropped my camera there. Brian, tell me whether that's move or face it down. So that's how we spotted him. There he is there. And he was sleeping on top of the table. Look at that. Isn't that a comfy leopard? Let me take my scarf off. I think my scarf is reflecting. Or if I do that, Brian, is that better? Oh, it's there he is, sleeping on top of the table, looking very comfortable. Right. Look at that. Well, he's up, so let's stick with live quarantine rather than pictures of quarantine. Maybe I'll go for a drink. Shamson's wondering, could quarantine pose a threat to Karula's cubs, or is he still too young? No, he definitely does pose a threat if he were to come back to Juma. But currently where he is, he doesn't pose a threat at all. He's quite far away from where they are. At the moment, the bigger threats to Karula's cubs would be Mvula and Sindile. Hi, Terry in Oklahoma. Terry would like to know, do I think Mvula is quarantine's father? Terry, I have no idea. And I'm not going to guess. It could easily be Mvula, it could be Tingana, it could be an unknown male leopard in the north. And he is an absolutely stunning leopard, this guy. He might go back to the top of his termite mound for another snooze. I love how they flatten their ears when they climb a termite mound initially to get a nice little view around. So is he going to sleep again? Or has he learnt his lesson? No, he's going to go down again. He's just... Brian, I think we don't even need to move. That's quite pretty. I still found the fact that he got bitten by a termite very funny. Hi, Douglas in Arizona. Douglas would like to know, was it not quarantine who climbed a tree to watch the last fireside chat of Big Cat week 2014? Brian, you were actually filming that, weren't you?
Yep, it was him indeed.
There we go. Brian was there, and it definitely was the quarantine male. Now, on a cool day like today, he could move, but I think it's definitely going to be worth coming to follow up on him on the sunset safari. But we're going to stick with him for the rest of the sunrise safari, that's for sure. So while we sit here waiting to see what quarantine does next, let's go see what the winter farmer is up to.
The winter farmer, Brent, that's nice, thanks. We've moved into this area away from where we were with an elephant bull just recently because there were some alarm calls from impala coming from here. Now, yesterday on the walk, on the sunset bushwalk, for those of you that joined us with the sunset bushwalk, Karula's tracks with the cubs were coming in this way on top of the male leopard's tracks that we were following. And I don't think that she's actually left this area, to be honest. I think that she's still here. Taxon, one of the Juma guides, is saying that she's moved her cubs into this area mainly because water has dried up in Treehouse Dam. And with that, herds have moved away. And it's surprisingly lacking in predators, which is what she's looking for. Now, that goes a little bit against what the tracks and signs are saying on the ground. Lot of activity of leopard, lot of hyena around here. Both male leopard and hyena are fatal to cubs. So I don't quite know what it is. She may just be moving into this area because she's hunted out other areas. And although she's now a mom and her primary concern would be looking after those two young cubs, she's also still a leopard in her prime that is as a territory to patrol and to manage. Otherwise, she's going to get encroached upon, and that has other long-term effects for leopard. But I'm probably the worst person to come into this area, because to be quite honest with you, my luck at finding leopards is very poor. But Karen has just asked me, how do I know how old tracks are? Or how can we tell how old the tracks of the leopards are? Corin, you have a look at the elasticity of the soil. You push your finger into the soil and you compare where you've pushed your finger to that mark on the soil. That'll give you an